afternoon. Welcome to the Winchester Multicultural Network's second Winchester In Transition Community Conference, WIT 2013. We are delighted each of you is here and want to acknowledge that many of our representatives are also here, including State Senator Catherine Clark. As I mentioned your name, could you stand and just give a wave? Thank you very much. State Representative Jason Lewis. Board of Selectmen members Jennifer Wilson. Doug Marmon. Tom Howley. And also the school committee is represented, the planning board is represented, the schools are represented. We have a lot of people who are listening to what all of us will be saying. I'm not Saul Gittleman, by the way. My name is Phil Coon, a 37-year resident of Winchester. I'm a relatively new member of the current 19-member network board. Since all the other board members are especially active and many have key network leadership roles, giving me the honor of welcoming you must reflect the network's commitment to inclusion of all. The Winchester Multicultural Network began in 1991. Our mission is to promote the recognition, understanding, and appreciation of diversity, to advocate for each and every person's civil rights, to confront intolerance. On August 6, 2012, the Winchester Board of Selectmen adopted the following human rights statement. Winchester is a community that is grounded in respect for every individual and therefore protects all residents, employees, business owners, students, and visitors in the enjoyment and exercise of human and civil rights. It is town policy to ensure equal treatment and opportunity to all individuals, regardless of race, gender identity, ethnicity, religion, ideology, socioeconomic status, health, sexual orientation, age, military status, or disability. This statement is in the back of your program. To help realize the Selectmen's vision of a truly inclusive town and to celebrate the network's 20th anniversary, last year on February 11th, we had our first WIT conference right here. Over 150 residents from different backgrounds gathered here to address 10 challenging issues. Throughout the day, all here were encouraged to keep in mind enriching multicultural transitions occurring within our town. And we benefited as many shared experiences and raised awareness of the opportunities to improve life in our community. This year's conference will focus on four emerging themes from last year's conference: stress, accessibility, class, and changing demographics. To facilitate the dialogue on these themes, we have an illustrious team. Judith Allen of Transcending Consultants, if you could stand and give a wave, thank you very much. Paula Panagian of Worldview Services. Paula Aimer, Associate Professor of Sociology and Director of Africa and the New World at Tufts University. And Dr. Bert Push, who is graciously replacing Barbara Chandler for the accessibility session. More detailed information about each of these expert facilitators is in your program. Facilitators, for giving of your expertise this Sunday afternoon as we again come together to build a stronger, resilient, and inclusive community, we thank you. I also want to introduce Marianne Bazzi, our event planner. Where's Marianne? She has 22 years of corporate experience. She's highly sought after as a coach, consultant, and public speaker. She's the editor of Disability Issues, a quarterly newsletter. She has an awesome website, disabilityvisibility.com. We are so lucky we had her. Our lead sponsor today is Community Health Network Area 15, or CHINA 15. CHINA 15 was initiated in 1992 by the Massachusetts Department of Public Health. CHINA's vision is that each and every community will be a safe and supportive environment that empowers community members to develop self-esteem and personal responsibility to make positive and healthy life choices. Thank you, CHINA 15, for making WIT 2013 a reality. We also thank the Winchester Disability Access Commission. Ian Costas, the town's Disability Access Coordinator, could you stand for us? Is she here? She's not here yet. She's on her way. And the Winchester School of Chinese Culture for their generous support. I know Jennifer Zhang is here. She's Director of Outreach. Could you stand? Thanks, Jennifer. In addition to our generous sponsors, we have 30 town organizations that have partnered with us in having this community conference. They are listed in the program. Every one of those organizations has to have a manageable focus, but none of them are parochial when it comes to trying to serve the broader community. Thank you, partner organizations. A major achievement and milestone of the network's 21st year was selecting our first executive director from among several truly outstanding applicants. So it is with great pleasure I introduce to you Catherine Ann Hart, executive director of the Winchester Multicultural Network. Most recently, Kathy Ann was the director and assistant general counsel at AIDS Action Committee of Massachusetts, Inc. She has a JD from Harvard Law School, where she has fond memories of being a student attorney of the Harvard Legal Aid Bureau and a founder of a diversity task force. Prior to her advocacy work at AIDS Action, she was an associate in the corporate department of Ropes and Gray, LLP. At Ropes, Kathy Ann was an active member of the Attorneys of Color group. After being an attorney at Ropes, she worked as a senior diversity consultant for Vernon Myers Consulting Group. Please welcome Kathy Ann.
When I hear people say things about me, I'm like, that's me? When did I do all that? But thank you, Phil, and thank you, Phil, and all the other dedicated volunteer leadership of the network. You know, Phil and sort of undersold himself at the beginning. Every member of our board and our community advisors really make this organization what it is today. I mean, it's surprising when any nonprofit lasts as long as 20 some odd years, and certainly one with volunteer leadership without some of paid staff at the helm. So I applaud all the network volunteers who are here and who are not here today. And I joined the network in January, and I couldn't really believe my good fortune to have found such a dedicated, smart, fun group of folks who wanted me to work with them. You know, heck, these are people I would hang out with anyway. folks who value inclusion and aren't afraid to say so and to do something about making it happen. For as far back as I can remember, when I was a child growing up on the island of Trinidad, I valued diversity and community. My maternal grandmother, who was born in Dominica, not the Dominican Republic, but the other island, had 16 children. She was a woman with a fifth grade education and a heart of gold, welcoming to any and everyone. Her children intermarried across race, ethnicity, class, national origin, and socioeconomic status. So our family gatherings are very, very diverse. In my home today, my husband is Egyptian. My daughter is a mix of several ethnicities, as am I. My husband is Muslim, I'm Christian. So personally, I'm pretty much entrenched in cross-cultural dialogue all the time. Just about every organization that I've been in, and Phil mentioned a few of them, I've worked with leadership to figure out how we can make it a better place for everyone who had to work there or get goods and services from that organization. And whenever I did it, whether it was in the personal professional arena, it was never alone. It was always with a team of folks who were as committed as I was to whatever we were working on. So I'm exceedingly grateful to see you all here, from those in government, those in the private sector, those who are students, those who are teachers, retired professionals, blue-collar workers, white-collar workers, those who are un or underemployed. You know, everyone in this community has the potential to add value. And we, as the Winchester Multicultural Network, value that. So no matter what hardships or tough spots or rough patches we may encounter as issues arise, even in those times or on those issues that seem to be pulling us apart, we will be better for it when we come together, at least that's been my experience, and working together as best we can, not setting aside our differences, but valuing them, appreciating them. And now, it is my great pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, Saul Gittleman. He's a longtime resident of the Winchester community and a professor at Tufts University. You could read all about Saul in your program. There's a bio in there, a bio which includes being a recipient of several awards, including two Fulbrights. But in addition to what you read in the program, from what I've learned about Saul in conversations with him, is that this is a man who values the ways in which he's different himself, and likewise appreciates the same in others. Here's Saul.
If I hold on to this podium very hard, it's because there should be a separate section for the elderly neurotic, which is what I would be going to. Every time I see a stage, I can't help but think of the time I was lecturing at school back home, and I walked off the stage, and they go back, picked me up. So I really get very nervous when I see a stage, but I'll hold on to this podium and not start walking around, because I'm a danger when I do to myself and everyone else. I am not the main course of these workshops. The workshops themselves are. I'm a very old hors d'oeuvre that you need a little bit of an appetizer for, just to get your juices flowing. In that respect, let me offer you a Rip Van Winkle moment. Part fantasy, part fact. The reality began when in 1967, that's 46 years ago, the Gittlemans and their three young children left their university rental apartment in Medford, having purchased their first and only permanent home the year round. This was a 10-room, 5-bedroom stucco house on Fletcher Street in Winchester, near Wedge Pond, the tennis courts, and the cemetery. It seemed to offer us everything. The house was derelict, the owner having died, and the sale on behalf of the relatives had been turned over to a law firm in Wilmington, Massachusetts. The asking price was $31,500, a bit out of our range, and the mortgage rules required that we put down 20% of the purchase price. Since we had a total of $6,000 in savings, we plotted to offer $25,000, which would have left us with a $1,000 cushion in our bank account. It was our first bid anyway, and we did this in the spirit of practice, never expecting them to accept our really inadequate offer. Well, the call came from a lawyer after the weekend. The house was ours. When reality hit us, we hesitated for a moment and looked at each other. We had had some reservations even looking in Winchester. The town was almost totally white and very churchy. Cardinal Cushing had already gone on television and proclaimed that Winchester would be the Milton of the North Shore, a Catholic community of prosperity and faith. There were also 7 Protestant houses of worship within walking distance of our house, and Church Street seemed to take its name very seriously. Our colleagues at Tufts had told us not to look in Winchester, that we would not be shown certain areas of real estate, and that the real estate people would know that we were not Christian, and some parts of town would be out of bounds for us. Could we fit? But we then realized that we had found a house we could afford, the kids could walk to the Wyman School, it was a 10-minute commute to Tufts, and Fletcher Street, it turned out, was its own world, an academic enclave made up of faculty from 4 of the 40 colleges and universities within commuting distance to Winchester. We took the house, and 46 years later, we're still there. Those are the facts. Now the fantasy. It's February 1965.
I'm waiting to buy gas at the Mobile station next to the Winchester Cinema on Main Street. By the way, the sign says, gas, 30 cents a gallon. I fall asleep. I wake up 48 years later in a stall in Bruger's Bagel Store on a Saturday morning. The three kids behind the counter are Afro-American, South Asian, and white. The place is jumping, warm and crowded, with bagels of every shape and description. There are two families of South and East Asian extraction. One is smearing a lox-infused cream cheese onto one set of bagels. The other is sharing with the three children in the booth a jalapeno pepper salad with ham, bacon, and sausage. One of the customers is asking whether there is a pizza bagel. I slap myself in the face, go outside, walk a couple of blocks around town, past the Starbucks, which also looks like a mini United Nations, and ask myself, am I still in Winchester? Of course I am. But I know the years have changed just by looking at the price of gasoline. Whether people like it or not, whether the change has come too slowly or not, Winchester has been caught up in the same forces that make America what it is. Alexis de Tocqueville, nearly 200 years ago, said this country was different. He used his native French word, exceptionnel, to describe us. We mistranslated it to mean better. De Tocqueville just meant different. He pointed out that everyone, except the Native Americans who were being cruelly brutalized, came from somewhere else, overwhelmingly European, except for the black slaves who came in chains from Africa. He acknowledged that the country was clearly dominated by white European Protestants, who, he noted, at times showed little tolerance for each other. During his three-week stay in Boston, he visited the monument to Mary Dyer, the Quaker woman who was hanged on the Boston Common in 1660 by intolerant Protestants, some of whom were Harvard graduates and were on the Harvard faculty. She was hanged because she was a Quaker. If Winchester had existed in the 17th century, there's no telling what kind of riots might have taken place along Church Street. American Protestants generally detested each other. Calvinists burned the houses of Huguenots in Worcester, drowned Baptists on the banks of the Charles, and they would certainly have done the same thing on the banks of the Abrajohnan. They formed their little religiously exclusive colleges. Congregationalist Harvard, Calvinist Yale, Baptist Brown, Evangelical Presbyterian Princeton, and Anglican William and Mary, just to keep their children and their parishioners away from each other. They accused each other of heresy and even witchcraft. The hanging of 20 innocent people in Salem in 1693 and four Quakers in Massachusetts colony was the natural outcome of faith gone mad. The devil was indeed loose in New England. The Protestants only stopped fighting with each other when Europe ran out of Protestant immigrants and the Irish Catholics arrived in the 1840s. They were described in the Boston press as, quote, maggots and vermin, unquote. But this is the great American paradox. Welcomed or not to these shores, these people keep coming, seeking a better life than the ones they left behind. And that has been the American story, the American paradox. People were unwelcomed, but they kept coming. Our motto as a nation has been, quote, be like us or else, unquote. And as each boatload of immigrants arrived, they struggled with those already here, learned their ways and eventually their language, and settled in. Initially, very few were welcomed. The Germans, still today, but perhaps not for long, the largest immigrant ethnic group in America, were despised because they wouldn't give up their language. As late as 1900, there were 60,000 school children being instructed in German-only public schools in Wisconsin, Minnesota, and Texas. There were other immigrant groups that were not considered white, the biggest insult you could give anyone. First, the Irish, who were also Catholic. Then the Italians, whom the Irish hated, in spite of sharing their Catholic faith. And the Jews, who weren't even Christian. They were all hated, but they persisted and finally made it in America. Color of skin has always been part of the issue of manifest destiny, the God-given right of Europeans to conquer this land from sea to shining sea, the power that drove this country to its 19th century geographical triumphalism. And the next 50 or 100 years will be a challenge for Winchester and America, because the Europeans are no longer the desperate, white, impoverished immigrants who came before. America shut its doors after 1920 when two Italian anarchists held up a paymaster in Braintree, Massachusetts. We slowly opened them again 50 years after the execution of Sacco and Vanzetti. And now we wrestle with the issue of who should be allowed onto our shores. But they will come, and they will be people of color. They will be black, brown, yellow, and some white. And eventually, they will all join this community. In our community particularly, some will be academics because of the extraordinary accessibility for them to their university jobs. They will be commuters to Boston because Winchester is in the Guinness Book of Records for having the two closest railroad stops in the world. But others might be waitstaff or owners of the now nearly dozen ethnic restaurants and food shops that bless this town. There will be issues to deal with that are reflected in the workshops today: stress, accessibility, class, and demographics. Nothing changes, and everything changes. Winchester, with its restaurants alone, Japanese, Chinese, Korean, Thai, Italian, Greek, reflects the extraordinary diversity that this community is capable of. And there are even two bagel stores. Well, long live Brugger's and Bagelland. And long live the paradox of America and Winchester. Welcomed or not, legal or not, people will find a way to get here and learn to love it. Now let's get to the business of living together. Thank you.